So, Mary Ellen, we're approving March 8th and...
13th.
And 13th. I move we approve the minutes.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye, me too. Moving on, scheduled appointments. Ed Berman.
Thank you. And then thank you for having me. I'll try to be brief. Numerous commentators in the last several months have noted the parallels between the United States in 2017 and Germany in 1937.
Or 33.
One can agree with these assessments or not agree with these assessments. I suspect it depends on what one reads and one's political affiliation. But regardless of whether you agree or disagree, there is one undeniable fact, and that is that today's immigrants and Muslims are Germany's Jews. They are blamed for almost everything that's wrong in contemporary America. They are regularly being demeaned and demonized. Like the Jews in the 1930s in Germany, the immigrants and the Muslims today are scapegoats being used for narrow political gains. The claims against them have absolutely no basis in fact. That does not seem to bother an awful lot of people in powerful positions. Why is this relevant today? How is it relevant today? Is it relevant today? In the 1930s and 1940s, too few people in Germany spoke out, either because they were believers, they believed the propaganda. Probably more often they didn't speak out because they didn't believe it. Or lastly, they didn't speak out because they were afraid to speak out for fear of any retribution that might come their way. All of that raises, of course, significant moral and personal issues. Should the Germans and the Austrians and those in the know in the 1930s have spoken out, have done more? Could they have done more? Translated along 80 years later to today, what responsibility do we have to protect those who are being scapegoated and persecuted? It's a personal choice. One does what one feels is right. One does what one feels, what one believes. That's not the reason we're here tonight. The reason that I asked to come tonight was to ask what kind of position the town, qua town, should take on this issue. The town will at some time, I suspect, have to make a decision about these kinds of issues. Now, I suspect, on the basis of no evidence, I could be wrong, I suspect that many of the farm workers that we all see along River Road and adjacent areas during the summer are illegal immigrants. If I'm wrong, this is probably not relevant. If I'm right, however, I think the issue that needs to be addressed is what will the town do if the town, through its police force, will be asked to cooperate with the officers from the Immigration and Customs Enforcement Service? Is the police force legally bound to comply with requests from the Immigration and Customs Service? The answer to that is no, they're not. I said to Jim when I sat down, I'm glad he's here, I wonder if this issue has been discussed amongst the board, in the town administration, or indeed on the police force. So that's why I raised this issue. And I think if the issue has not been raised, I think as a town, we certainly have a moral issue to look at it.
Okay. So what would you like from the town, from the board, for instance?
I would like to know from the board and from the chief of police what will happen if I'm correct, if illegals come along in one of those little green buses during the summer from either Holyoke or Springfield, and they're stopped by the Immigration and Customs Enforcement officers, and they then ask Jim behind us to detain them for several hours or several days while they can be, while their papers can be checked and the papers can be processed so that they can be deported.
Okay.
That's the issue, I think, basically.
So what are you asking the town to do? I still don't understand what you're asking us to do.
To protect.
I'm asking the town to protect any so-called illegal who might be detained by the Immigration Service and ask for town support doing that.
Why?
If the Immigration Service all of a sudden stops a bus coming up from Holyoke and says, we need to unload all you people, we need to send them to the local lockup, and they ring up the police chief behind me and say, can we stick these people in one of your cells for a bit? What's going to happen?
Well, personally, I would say, as you pointed out, and not standing idly by, would say that the ICE should do their work and our police force should do its work. And there's no connection between the two. And I would just as soon keep it that way. Personally, now, we haven't voted as a board on this, but I think if we're in our legal purview to be able to so move, that would be a motion I would entertain, that our police force should not assist the immigration, the ICE people, if they don't have to by statute, which if they don't, then we don't have a problem.
My understanding is by statute they do not have to.
Okay.
And I could be wrong. I don't think so, though.
Well, that's my personal. Fred, how do you feel about it?
Yeah, I kind of agree with you. I guess if it's up to immigration or the police, whoever has authority to do whatever they have to do, that's up to them. We need to take a position and do anything different in the town. I mean, it's kind of like, what about underage employees? Nobody's looking at that. Is anybody questioning that? That's probably could be as big an issue as this.
It's not an issue right now. There's an issue immediately in front of us.
Well, you're trying
to divert the issue to something else.
Okay. You're
going to solve this problem.
You know that this is happening in this town?
As I said, I do not know if it's happening. I hope that I'm wrong. I suspect, however, that it is happening.
We don't know. And until I guess we hear otherwise, from some confirmed source that this is happening in town and is a problem, I'm kind of agreeing with Paul that we don't need to do anything more. It's up to the policing authorities to do this.
Well, actually, I was saying something slightly different. I was saying that we should not involve ourselves in matters of immigration enforcement or operations. We should just stay out of it and let them do their job. That is to say, instruct our police officers not to intervene in doing,
immigration enforcement.
Yeah, that's not our preview. Our preview is to protect and defend and ensure the public safety of anybody in Whately, including immigrants. They should be defended by our police department just like anybody else. That's where I would go.
Maybe we should take a second. Bring Jonathan into the conversation.
Yes, let's bring Jonathan.
Because I'm sure this is
so
tough to walk into.
Ed here is bringing up a concern about a lot of our workers in the field. We may be undocumented workers. And he is requesting, if I get this right, that we do not aid and abet the immigration authorities in dealing with any matters of illegal immigration. which is under the purview of ICE and not the Whately Police Department.
Right, and the Whately Police Department has plenty to do on its own.
And it's not required to do anything.
And you know, and
it already does.
I do agree with you that with the relatively large number of immigrant workers, migrant workers that we have, my hope is that they feel comfortable coming to work, because I know that the farming community in this town absolutely needs those workers, because they don't find them anywhere else.
So
because they spend a lot of money bringing people in as a migrant worker population, and then those people send a lot of money back to their families.
Well, and as I said just before you came in, I said I have no documented evidence that there are illegal immigrants on the buses. I suspect that, I would be surprised if that were not the case, though.
Yeah, I don't know, and I don't want Jim or Don or any of the part-timers spending their time enforcing something that they, correct me if I'm wrong, Jim, have very little background in. We have our own issues to deal with in town.
Or authority to deal with their issues, either.
I'm not going to give them the authority. If the federal government wants to come in here and harass agriculture workers, you know, nothing we can do about that. But I don't want our police force.
No, I don't either.
No.
So.
I mean.
So I think you got my support. I mean, I'm not going to.
Is this something that should go to?
Well.
Town meeting.
Petition.
A town meeting resolution. Or is it just a statement?
Well, I think the select board could instruct the police department accordingly. We don't need to go to a town vote, although we could.
I mean, anybody could get a signed petition to bring a resolution to the floor of town meeting. You know, we are, as I'm constantly reminded, the executive branch of this town. We are not the legislative branch of this town. Much as that's an odd thing to grasp. So, you know, and that would only raise the volume of the issue, perhaps. Yeah. But again, I don't want it to deflect from the issues that really we need to focus on town meeting floor. Just on a daily, let's figure out how to run this town and deliver the services, but
I think it's a jurisdictional issue, and we don't have jurisdiction over this issue, and we shouldn't act as if we do.
Right. You know, I would suggest people that, you know, go talk with the district attorney and get that. What are they doing on the matter? What, you know, and I think that's even closer to the purview of those. It's just not ours, so I'm with you.
Obviously, I agree, but there is and will be increasing pressure on, you know, local jurisdictions to do this coming out of Washington, as we know.
Yeah, but with our current governor, who's made it very clear that he has no top patience for what's coming out of Washington, that pressure comes from this, you know, trickles down. Yeah. Donald Trump, if he's worried about what's happening in 1,400 person Whately, Massachusetts,
you know. Well, you know, it raises
nothing else to do.
It raises a good. A sort of interesting question, and I would ask our town administrator to look into your statement, Jonathan, about our being an executive branch. We're to enforce, if we're strictly executive, it's to enforce the legislative initiatives that ultimately stem from town meeting. On the other hand, I don't know what leeway we have to promulgate our own sort of regulations or advisements. If we can, I would say we can instruct the police force not to cooperate with ICE on matters of immigration.
Yeah, Chief.
I just have a question. I'm not taking sides of this at all, but what happens if immigration comes in and something escalates to the point where now some of our citizens are at risk, and does that mean the police department doesn't respond?
Sure, then the police department should respond if there's a threat of public safety to Whately residents, right?
But I'm saying if they get called to the scene because it escalates into something more so than just detaining.
But then I think it's a matter of public safety.
Right. Okay.
If it's just a matter of checking documentation, detaining right, people, okay. That doesn't.
I was confused in regards to if immigration calls and says they need our assistance, they need the police department assistance. Because it's escalating, then it becomes a public.
Yeah, but I don't think they're going to do that. I mean, if ICE comes in here, if Immigration Services comes in here, then it's their jurisdiction, and in theory, they have some orders to do whatever
they probably have a lot more resources than
yeah.
They have as they
want. And if they really, you know, and I would argue, we shouldn't be of assistance to them only because they've got their own job to do.
Right. Exactly.
We're a one-person police force on a regular basis,
right.
In terms of shifts,
and not trained in this area. Of
come on, exactly. You know it's just
behavior.
So.
I guess I would ask, just for information, Jim. What does the state police do in these instances? Have you seen any correspondence, guidance, or aware of anything going on with them that's different than maybe you would do?
At this point, we haven't had. Any directives, any initiatives, anything that's come up stating that we have, that we're mandated, that we have to do any specific thing. I mean, we're law enforcement officers, so we enforce the laws. If state police came in and had an investigation about whatever it might be, if they didn't need our assistance, they might not need our assistance, we can go back to securing the town. It would be the same thing would apply, you know, taking politics and everything else out of it. If there was a public safety concern, then we would do our jobs.
I want Jim and Don officers working on High Five Friday.
Seriously, I do. I don't want them worrying about immigration.
Like I said, it's not a political thing from my perspective. If there's a law that's broken, we're going to enforce the law. And we've gotten called to numerous incidents at farms where there may be questionable people there. We don't take immigration violation action. We get information for the report and then we forward it on to the district attorney's office. If they want to take action, then that's up to them to pursue it further. But we don't have the staff, we don't have the facility. We can't facilitate that. If immigration comes in, immigration control, if they come in and say, we need you to detain these 10, 15 people, we don't have the physical ability to do that.
Well, we don't even want you to do it.
Yeah.
Even if you had the
right, because that takes time away from other stuff like High Five right. Friday.
Yeah. So that's our feeling about the matter. If you all want to bring a warrant article via petition to the town meeting, then I guess we could make it more legal official policy.
I don't mind my contract. Turn around pretty quick.
Yeah.
What's that?
It'd have to be turned around pretty quick.
Right.
It would be.
But how many signatures do they need? Not many.
10.
10 good ones.
Good ones.
Well, I get that.
How big a brouhaha do you want to town meeting?
Well, that's the, I mean.
Well, I don't know. How big a brouhaha are you getting here? Not a big one.
I can't see that people object to it.
No.
Well, and as Jonathan pointed out, too, it's not only an ethical situation and a legal situation because we don't have legal jurisdiction over this kind of activity, but it's also an economic one, and we're heavily dependent on these workers, and there's, you know.
It'll be the luck of the draw. If it gets voted down, then there's a whole new ballpark.
No, maybe it's better not to bring it up.
I would just run with what you've got.
Right. Yeah. It's just not, it's not going anywhere.
He's got our support.
And again, Governor Baker, to his credit, has been pretty clear to avoid the topic at all costs, because he thinks it's silly. So.
Well, I think basically we just want the support of the alderman and of the police department.
Yeah.
What?
We've gotten requests for other people have sent emails kind of questioning what we're going to do, how we would handle the situation. I'm kind of being reserved about it because I don't have enough information. I'm looking into the matter to determine if we had some sort of public conversation. There's people that want to meet with me to discuss what our actions are going to be.
Well, I would deflect them here.
Yeah,
you don't have policy making authority.
You can tell them that we don't want you to assist ICE, and that if they want to talk about it, they can come to us.
And again, those are things that I'm not 100% sure about all that. I mean, if it's a law...
We're sure up here, so...
But policy versus law are...
He's not sure if ICE overrides your decision.
I think it does.
It doesn't.
It does.
There's no mandate.
I think it's going to be a great court case at some point.
And it will be.
Check on it through his channels.
But...
Well, until that...
But again, I'm going to reserve any comments until I find out more information, and then we'll, I mean, if there's further discussion, if people want to discuss it individually to see what our approach is going to be to it.
Yeah, but Jim, I mean...
Well, I want to know what your approach is going to be to it, because we're saying your approach should be what we're saying it should be.
But that's your approach. I don't know if that's...
But let me put it this way, Jim. If I have a, as I think you know, I have a lot of respect for the police department in this town. If all of a sudden saw the police department putting a tremendous number of resources into what I consider not a priority of the town, it would make me wonder whether we need the number of shifts that we do. If there's time to go put your arms around, and I'm not saying you, but if any department has the time to, in a small rural community, has the time to partner with ICE on immigration services, then they've got far too much time on their hands dealing with what they should be doing. That, I guess, so it's...
Yeah, no, and I've clearly stated we don't have that resource. We don't have the ability to do that right at this point. Like, as far as what's mandated, what's not mandated, I just...
If you get any communication from federal authorities about this, have them come meet in our little cubicle here.
Okay, I think we're pretty clear here.
And thank you for your time.
Sure.
Thank you for your interest.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.
You won't take the screw if we go and have dinner?
You're not going to stay? That's a new policy here.
No,
if you speak at this meeting, you have to stay the entire
grandchild control.
Or you need to come bring us the dinner.
Thank you, Kevin.
Thank you.
I don't think it's 1938. I think it's earlier than that. We got a ways to go.
Hopefully.
Well, hopefully we don't go there. Okay, Paul Antea, FY18 budget review. Not being here, I guess we can skip this.
Well, we shouldn't skip that.
I know.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's our segue into this
6:30.
Much interesting topic.
Yes.
Of budget review.
So we're not going to do old business first?
Paul's not going to be here at all.
Oh, he's not going to be here at all?
No.
Oh, I missed that.
Yeah, he called me at 3:30 today. So, how do we want to go about this? We've had our joint meetings with the Finance Committee.
You want to report back to us what the Finance Committee findings were?
Yeah.
Okay.
So there's a sheet in here that says Finance Committee. I mean, do you want an overall? Do you want me to run through an overall summary of the budget, or you just want to talk about what they talked about?
I think it'd be good to do a summary for the viewing audience to get them prepared for town meeting.
Okay.
A quick summary.
I'm gonna summarize this document called Preliminary Omnibus Budget 3A.
What page are you on? Page one.
What's up the packet?
So budget projection number 3A?
Nope, next, keep going. Nope. It's portrait print.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay.
I'll talk about the budget categories here. Total town operations, this is page two, we'll talk about. So the total town operations for FY18 is down 1.04% from FY17. So it's down $21,281. The decreases are mainly attributable to the lower overall health insurance costs in terms of how they're budgeted, and then the 15% reduction in the South County EMS assessment. Those were two of the big decreases in the budget for the town operations. Moving down to the next budget category, school operations. School operations is up 3.92% from FY17. That's $103,000. That includes the elementary school, Franklin Tech, and Frontier Regional. The last category on that sheet is our debt service payments. The debt service payments are down $92,342, or 41%. What came off, we made final payments on the town office building, and we made final payments one of the loans for the highway department vehicles.
Can we go back to the schools for a second?
Yep.
So the biggest percentage change seems to be transportation. No.
Franklin Tech.
Franklin Tech. And that's just a matter of having more students go there?
It's a matter of having more students go there, and it's a matter of our minimum contribution increasing.
And why did it increase? Because of the student population?
It's the formula, so it's based on values and...
So we have no control over that. Okay.
We have... This is kind of what I wanted to get into a little bit, and we talked about with the finance committee a little bit. You know, we want to keep this brief, but we have little control over it when we start talking about it, you know, January 1. We have little control over it.
Yeah.
So in terms of the elementary school budget and Frontier, I think we need to start a conversation maybe in the summertime. Because really what happened this year was we had these large decreases. The health insurance, the debt service payments, those reductions kind of covered up the $103 increase in schools, and I don't see where those
$103,000.
I don't see where those reductions are going to come next year to offset the increases in the schools. So,
right. So it's a structural issue.
It's a structural issue, and it's something that, if we try to address it, you know, come January 1st and we're pushing up against our budget deadline, it's a tough road to hoe. So one of the things I hopefully we can start doing late spring or early summer is try to engage the other four towns, frontier towns, and start looking at ways to...
Is the tech school figure slated to change much next year? Or is that going to be constantly at 162 for a couple of years?
When I look in the past, it fluctuates some. I think 162 is probably the highest I've seen.
And what is Smith School? Is that, that's been...
It depends how many students. That's a tuition basis.
That's tuition.
So we could have a student go there and boom, we'd be... Yep. Yeah. And the transportation associated with it would also increase.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So you're right. There's a structural problem with school financing. This year it's covered up with those reductions in other areas of the budget. But if increases of this size keep coming, we're going to start feeling it. Probably in terms of the tax rate or reduction. Quality or quantity of services that the town provides.
Brian, did you look? I don't remember it off the top of my head. You may have drilled down a little bit more deeply than I did, and I'm hoping you did. Was there, looking at the overall Franklin Tech budget?
Yeah.
What are their driving expenses? The overall budget must have. I get that our formula forced an increase for us, but what are their driving expenses that I'm assuming rode up their overall budget? Because it's not just the formula that we're getting hit with. I can't imagine.
We did vote their maintenance last year. All the towns.
Say that again.
I think we voted their repairs last year.
Capital.
There was capital.
Capital.
That was a big one. There.
Remember they presented at all the meetings?
Yeah.
I don't know if that's it. That might be something.
That's
an ongoing. That wasn't a one-shot deal.
Right.
And this says operating, not capital.
Right. You're right. It's the existing capital. Or no, there's just operating. There's no capital line item under the budget here in the summary.
I mean, I suspect some of it, I suspect some of it's salary. That's what's driving a portion of it up.
Well, right, but salary, I mean, proportionally, if we're going up 36%, and other people are going up probably less than 36%, the other three towns, that's not just salary increases.
For Franklin Tech?
Yeah, that's not just salary increases. I mean, the transportation increase at Frontier is, you know, it's only $3,000. So that's not a big hit on this overall budget, as much as it burns me up that we pay that kind of cash for a bunch of buses that nobody rides on.
So how the funding formula works, so there are some towns who are seeing a reduction in their assessments.
For?
Overall reduction, not just a smaller one.
For what, Franklin County Tech?
Yeah. So as our minimum contribution changes, as we pay more, others can pay less.
That means the formula changed at some level.
Right.
Why?
The minimum contribution formula?
Yeah.
I suspect it has to do with the equalized value of the town.
Oh, okay. I got you.
Income increasing. I suspect that's the biggest driver. But yeah, there are a number of towns here who are seeing decreased assessments based on the revised formula.
All right.
So I think you have your typical salary increases that you do.
So there's nothing we can do about that.
The formulas.
We can't do anything about the Franklin Tech. The Frontier budget going up 1.78%. I'm sorry, 2.1.
The biggest one is our elementary school going up to 40,000, 2.5%. And the dollar figure is considerably more in Frontier. And that's the area we should be focusing on for next year. What can we do to either reduce or stabilize that increase?
That's a $40,000. That sounds like a salary, a difference between. Maybe
probably a combination of.
I guess reading the papers, and I see other towns are questioning what their elementary schools are doing on the budgets. Because I didn't see that happening here that much. I don't know exactly.
Finance committee was okay with it.
Yeah. Again, part of the discussion we had with the finance committee was we need to start addressing FY19.
Right, I agree with
in
that.
In the summer, and lay out expectations, and try to identify areas of savings, whether there's some efficiencies that can be gained or.
Well, we're still waiting.
Just seeing what's driving these expenses. And to some extent, it is salary. There are salary increases built in. Teacher contracts and IA contracts, so there's that built-in increase that's going to show up every year.
Is that UMass study going to get into any of this level of detail on this that would help us, or is that just a broad brush overview of numbers?
The UMass study has not been sent to me yet.
Right.
My understanding was that wasn't what we're originally building, right?
Building occupancies and all that.
You know, I also don't want to. The schools are the biggest line item, but if you're talking about structural issues, the schools by a percentage basis are a lot smaller of an increase than other areas of this budget. A lot smaller percentage increase than a lot of the areas in this budget. So if we're going to hammer the schools for going up 2.5%, we need to be hammering other places for going up north of 4, 5, 10. I mean, we can't pick on a line item just because it's the largest line item. If you're looking at structural issues, you know, I'll pick on Tri-Town Beach for going up 9%. It's not a big number. So people say, oh, you know, it's not a big number. Why is it going up? Fire, police, you know, on and on and on. We can't pick on something just because it's a big ticket item. Because their percentage increase is small.
Well, then should it be looking at the dollar increase, right?
Well, you should be looking at both.
Look at both, but we're not, but I guess my point is in this conversation, we're not looking at both. We're just looking at the dollar.
No, I'm looking at the increase.
Well, the 40,000 increase, and it's like 2.55. We don't see anyone.
We don't?
Well, total for the
I'm saying item by item.
You know, like individual items. Yeah, animal control went up 13%. Well, that's what, $500 it went up.
Tri-Town Beach went up 9. Cemetery went up 13. Library went up 3. Senior center went up 9. We can't pick on something just because it's a big ticket item.
No, but surely we should look at big ticket items.
Oh, I get that. But it...
But then it has to come back to the finance committee. What do they look at?
I don't think anybody's picking on it. I think there was just a lack of visual look at it. We didn't have any time to even look at it. That's kind of where Brian's going.
And I agree with that. But I would argue that we need to... That our 3.5-month budget cycle for all town departments is the main flaw. It's not just the schools. It's we all of a sudden decide we better kick it into gear. It's January 1st. Well, what the heck are we doing the rest of the year with all these things?
Yeah. Well, and Brian's request was level funding. When he sent out the request for budget, consider level funding as the option we're going to look at, or criteria, or whatever we're looking at. You can see on here, not everybody looked at level funding.
Well, these include the COLA. Yeah. So most of them started at level funding.
Yeah, a lot are actually zeroed out.
Yeah, well, a lot. There's others that.
But they're tiny items, like $150, $500, $200.
And it makes me wonder whether going forward, whether we should be looking at, because I know a fair number of places create their budget by, you have your operating budget minus salaries. So then you can see how much of it is salary driven and how much of it is pencils and paper and hard cost driven. Sure.
Well, and I'd like to see some of these larger figures in pie chart form where you can actually see the size of certain slices relative to others as a part of the total budget.
And I think part of the reason may be all these departments and people that submit the budget have the... Maybe their own experience or the precedent set that if I just go up a little amount, they'll get it approved. Mm-hmm. So I want to buy something extra this year, so I'll put it in, whether we need it or not.
And
is a question.
As I eyeball this, by the way, I would say hats off to Keith, actually, because he's the one department that breaks out salaries that I can see. Maybe I'm missing something, but that's the one that I'm... At a quick glance,
they're all broken out in the really thick.
Not on the summary.
No.
On the summary.
In the budget book here.
Right, but on the summary, highway's broken out to, and that's a credit to him because.
Yeah.
Well, highway's also $367,000 versus zoning board of appeals $2,200 or
still
finance maybe $150.
If
do you really want to make them?
No, but and again, I'm not picking on salaries. I'm just saying let's treat it all the same. It's, you know, fire has salaries, police has salaries, we have salaries.
Yeah,
they're broken out here. Just,
but not.
No, this is the overview. This is
not in the
document.
Cheat sheet.
Right.
The cheat sheet is broken out by highway in highway.
Yeah, because those are the budget categories in highway.
Right. So I guess we don't even have consistent budget categories.
In which way?
in this way.
For these all departments?
Two-page summary.
This is right, this was what gets transferred to the warrant.
Right, so...
I think Brian's got the rest of it.
But...
For each one.
Maybe I'm not being clear.
So I have those figures.
I understand that, but maybe I'm not being clear. But this is what gets transferred to the warrant. This is the discussion point. The binder's not the discussion point. This is the discussion point on town meeting floor. And if I'm not sitting here and I'm sitting on town meeting floor, I see, okay, we have different departments have different line items.
Wow.
I mean, that's part of the structural, figuring out the structural challenges is partially the responsibility of us to have a consistent budgeting system. And we don't have it.
So do you make highway department one line item then?
No, I like the way you create your line items the way you create it, but if you're gonna have a salary line item in highway, you should have a salary line item in school operations, a salary line item in general government, a salary line item in public safety, you know.
There's one in the fire department.
What's that? Not, but my point is not with what's gonna be presented to the town meeting floor. That's my issue. I get that you have to report salaries. I totally get that.
But shouldn't this also be responsibility of finance committee to make sure these?
I'm not placing blame or responsibility. I'm saying we as a town need to figure this out.
Well, yeah, but doesn't it start at the finance committee? They get the first opportunity to look at this. Well, yeah, and they get all the detailed sheets that Brian has in the book.
I think Brian's point is right. We need to start looking at this on July 1st and not on January 1st.
Yeah, I agree with you. Because these are all estimates, and you know, once we get, say, free cash certified or other funds come in the fall, you know, it's gonna affect the budget, our tax rates, and whatever. And I don't see finance or anybody looking at that in the fall. It's, well, I guess it's good enough. We approved it at town meeting, so that's where we're going.
I mean, maybe we start looking at it in the fall, and then if people want to jump on and join us, that I hope they do. So what does this mean? What does this do if this were adopted as is?
Yep.
What does that do?
What does it do in terms of?
Are we balanced?
Are we talking tax rate? Are we talking?
I want to know if we're balanced.
Well, we do have balance in what sense? We have to balance our budget.
I understand that.
And we balance that by setting the tax rate.
With the current tax rate, would we be balanced?
Would we have the same tax rate?
Yeah.
No. So here's the catch. The town operations budget is down. The total non-enterprise fund budget is down $10,422. From FY17, so that's down 0.21%. But if you remember, we have a cherry sheet, and we have assessments on our cherry sheet, and we have receipts that we get on our cherry that show up on the cherry sheet, and we have charges that show up on the cherry sheet. We have an increase in what's called the stay in county charges line item, and that's for charter school tuition and school choice, charter school sending tuition and school choice sending tuition. Mm-hmm. So we have that increase of, what is it, 50, whatever it is here, $54,000 over FY17.
That's K-12, that's K-6, and then a portion of our 712.
Yeah, that's charter schools and choice.
And choice.
Now that's net?
That's on top of, that's an increase from FY17.
It's a net figure though. We're subtracting choice kids coming in and our choice kids coming out. So we're taking the difference?
No, that's just what we were charged for.
Oh, okay.
So for FY17, we paid nothing for charter school sending tuition.
I don't
don't know if there were no students or the legislature funded it differently.
Well, it could have been the first year, whatever it is.
Right.
Depends upon where the student is in the cycle.
So because we have that increase, we have to make that up. What I mean by that is, although we have a decrease in our town operations budget, we have an increase in state and county charges. So our overall expenses are up.
By how much?
With the projections that I've done here, we would be up around 35,000. That's very uncertain at this point in terms of what we're going to get from the state. This is just based on the governor's budget.
Right.
What that means is there would be we need to raise an additional $35,000. If we want to project out, you know, using the FY17 values, but again, if those go up, if values go up, tax rate's going to come down.
It's very fluid. That's why I don't like to focus too much on the tax rate. People care about how much they're writing a check for.
Right.
Why they're writing the check. That the tax rate itself.
It's going to move. So.
And so the $34,000 is either paid for out of increasing the tax rate, decreasing other line items, or free cash.
Say that one more time.
You can pay for the $34,000 out of increasing the tax rate.
Yep.
Cuts in other line items.
To reduce the overall town operations budget, yes.
Or free cash.
Or you could find additional sources of revenue. Yep, free cash would be one of them.
Yeah, I mean, it's not an infinite list of additional sources of revenue.
So here's our plug for economic development, because new development really helps. Especially commercial and industrial
especially
properties.
Commercial and industrial.
It really does.
And so at this point, just operating, we wouldn't, except for that 34, we wouldn't be touching free cash to balance.
No.
Okay, but see that, you didn't, okay.
No, we didn't get there yet.
Okay.
And it's part of the finance committee recommendation. That assumes a $200,000 appropriation of free cash to reduce the tax levy, which is what happened last, which is the same as last year.
Two was the last year? And it also doesn't include any capital.
No, we'll talk about capital. We'll talk about capital after this.
I'm just not sure you can talk about them individually.
They're voted separately.
But it's all how much money is being spent.
We're talking about how I'm trying to separate them, and it is all money spent, is the budgets that will impact the tax levy, and then capital items that will be paid for with existing funds.
What did the finance committee say?
Want to jump to that? Finance committee, in terms of the operations budget, they had one request, and that was the police department budget be reduced by $2,500 with the goal of reducing the proposed increase to approximately 5% over the FY17 budgeted amount. That was their one request.
Did they give a suggestion of where that 25 comes from?
No. There was no formal recommendation.
Did they give a rationale for why?
They thought the increase was high, I guess. The overall increase was high.
Well,
police department went up 6%.
Quinn bill incentive, is that does not include the Quinn bill incentive, though we'd have no control over that.
Correct.
Animal control went up 13%. So I get that they're looking at police because it's a pretty good sized ticket.
Now, a good portion of that was a salary increase voted by the personnel committee.
For police?
Yeah.
At what percent rate?
What was the salary adjustment based on those?
Right.
It's on salary survey.
Was it COLA?
It was in your...
It was an adjustment.
It was an adjustment based upon other towns.
Right, it's on the detail sheet here.
Right, and you know, and my struggle with that is every time the average is adjusted, you know, it's a cycle. Then some other town has to respond, and then another, and then it comes back to us, because we're...
I agree with you, it's circular, and it's worth taking a look at as to...
And we did take a look at, you know, we looked at the CPI and...
But it wasn't only the police department, there was about six or eight other positions, and Keith had some, I think, increased the rate because it was less than surrounding towns. Going back to your argument, Jonathan, keep increasing would be the average, and the average keeps going up, so...
I don't know how you get around that, but it's just the reality of it.
Well, the only way to get around it is to get together with all the other towns and say, hey, stop doing that.
Yeah.
Yeah, that'll work.
Good luck with that. Yeah. I'm sure Deerfield will fall right in line.
Yeah. I'm surprised they're not here.
Yeah.
So that was the Finance Committee's sole request.
But how did it come up with the 2,500? You don't know?
I don't know why that exact dollar.
All right, well, that's...
I mean, what came out of it was it would be around 5%. But I think that was backed out, kind of backed into it.
I'm not saying that, it just seems, I'm not, as much as I'd like to get political points with Jim here, I'm not defending the police department, but it seems arbitrary. One line.
Yeah. Well, we'll talk to them next week.
Do they have the detail sheet in front of them?
No.
Because there was an increase that I talked with Brian about, which we had discussed before, about the taser, the additional taser.
Oh,
$1,200.
Right.
If you take that one-time expenditure, because we didn't do it as a capital item.
Yeah.
If you do that one-time expenditure, then the overall increase is like 2,600 and change. So that's where my guess, and I haven't been given any rationale, my guess is that's where the 2,500 came from, because that's about what's left.
Yeah, I think you're pretty close.
To level fund it.
It was one of the items discussed.
So
there was some discussion in the Finance Committee meeting that my budget went up. $2,500, $2,600 minus that one-time expenditure, but nobody else's did. So it wasn't fair that ours went up and nobody else's did. That's what I got from my discussion with the Finance Committee.
But if you didn't show that in your budget, where else would it show up?
What do you mean? If I didn't show what?
The cost of the tasers, whatever.
Well, that's what I discussed with Brian, that there was a capital expenditure, or if it was a separate line item. He had suggested just doing it as a one-time expenditure out of the budget, because it didn't meet that $5,000 threshold for a capital expenditure.
Because, I mean, that may be a question come up on the town floor, you know, why the $12,000 increase?
Well, it was $3,600 minus that one-time expenditure, $2,600, yeah. The rest of it's salary. Yeah. That's,
I know,
that
I, hear, our, I hear Tim, but just the hands. People looking at the budgets at the town floor.
The vast majority of it is going to be the salary increases, because there was an adjustment for the full-time sergeant. There was a fairly substantial adjustment to get him to, based on what the study was, the salary study, to get him up to a more appropriate level. There was a larger increase there, and the rest of it was COLA increases. So that's where the largest portion of it came from, the salaries.
Look at this.
All right.
Well, that was the only item in terms of operations.
What else we need?
The next thing that we would talk about is if we want to, I mean, do we want to wait until the next meeting, or do you want to let the Finance Committee know how you feel about that.
That one adjustment?
Yeah. Or you just want to talk about it on the...
We can talk about it next week.
I just want to not adjust, just one.
Yeah, it does seem a little hard to bear.
Okay.
What you're going to hear, I believe, is we got the two tasers donated, and now they want to buy a third with ammo. There was a...
Oh, it's in the ammo?
Well, that and the, what, $1,200 for the other taser, whatever. There was just some... That's where the back and forth was.
You know,
if someone had not donated two tasers, there would be no request for an increase in the budget.
Right, and how much is that increase again?
For the taser?
For the additional taser and the ammo.
Well, it's $1,200 for the taser and the ammo and the training for that.
Okay, so if no one had donated the two tasers, it would be $1,200 less.
Yeah.
Okay,
so that gets us to $2,600.
Right, so but
$2,000.
Right, so I guess again, it feeds into my question. I can find $2,000 in a lot of other places here. Ton of them.
I'm just telling you.
Yeah, no, I get that. So I guess my point
where
is
the rub was
is that we as a town have to decide a prioritization of how we want to spend our money. Not randomly, but this is the town priority this year. This is the town priority next year. And we don't seem to ever do that. It just that sounds like a good idea today.
Well, I think your comment about starting this process earlier in the game has merit as long as we can get reasonable budget requests earlier in the game. Otherwise, we're just throwing dice with a blindfold on. You know, I think part of the reason we don't start earlier is because we don't know what departments are going to need until a certain time of the year. And once we get those budget requests, then we can sit down and compare it to last year's, or maybe we have an even longer budget horizon of 3 years.
Yeah, and I guess what I'm saying is that, you know, Brian requested a flat budget. And isn't a fun experience for the town administrator, acknowledging that. But then if you want, and we want, to have that flat budget from the different town departments, then we need to be involved with their, how did they come up with their budget from
sure.
early on, so that it's not all of a sudden January 1st and the flat doesn't get adhered to. Because it shouldn't be, I asked for zero, I didn't get it, I'm getting this now, now we have to deal with it. Whereas if you start having the conversations in July, August, September, you can start to sniff out that you're not going to get zero, or you might get zero, or why can't, what can you do without this time? If you want taser ammo, you're here, so I'm going to pick on you. Or if you want, I don't know.
Air packs.
Yeah. Or if Keith wants...
New equipment.
Or dump trucks.
Right, whatever. Then, okay, fine, but what can you possibly live without this year to offset that increase?
But who's going to decide that? Is it come to the
we do.
The finance budget people saying, okay, Keith, you don't need that.
No.
Buy new equipment this
we're,
year.
No, we're the policy arm of this town.
Yeah, but how detailed do we get?
The finance committee is shut, not you.
No.
We're policy.
We're policy. They're fiduciary responsibility.
There's no money, there's no policy.
Right. But how detailed?
But they
just
don't get me going on that one.
No, submit the budget to town meeting.
Yeah, let's get a fire truck, we'd say. And they'd say, here's how much it'll cost. And we say, it's pretty expensive. Can we afford it?
Right. What are we going to do without if we get that fire truck?
Right. And they'll say, we can afford it or we can't afford it.
You know, we
do this every year. So, you know, I think what we're trying to do is...
If you say no, they can still say yes.
We're trying to get to a point where this is as smooth a process as possible.
Right, and we're getting better. This was a much better year than previous years.
Well, because we had joint meetings.
Right, and hats off to the finance committee and, you know.
Right.
And finance committee budget went down 68%.
There you go. They practice what they preach.
Yeah. They saved like what, $48 or something?
Out of $150 budget.
Oh, there was something beating.
There's some items.
Agricultural commission.
Well, you know, I mean, it also, we have we coordinated with the capital budgeting process and trying to get that free of surprises.
It's a good segue.
However, hey, possible.
I don't want to belabor this, but I'm just curious. Can you look up real fast why the increase in the Tri-Town Beach budget?
Yep.
So we're not picking on one department, potentially.
By the way, the departments constitute
about... I think I'm going to tell Sally, but let me double check.
Okay.
General government constitutes about, you know, 8% of the total budget. That's all departments.
Right. I get
so,
that.
You know,
it's small.
It's Tri-Town
Beach.
It's
small. So those tasers are 0.00002%.
So salaries.
I'm not saying that's not important, but it's pretty small.
Yeah.
Salaries are up 10.45%. So they're up $1,600. And then what I so I break out salaries in general.
Yep.
So I break out salaries and operations. Operations is up 150. So it's salaries.
150%.
$150.
Oh.
4.08%, but $150.
Okay, well, I mean, I could make a motion that we level fund Tri-Town Beach. I guess this is my point.
But then, like you were saying, why pick on Tri-Town Beach?
Well,
finance is picking
thank
on
you.
Police, so.
I know, thank so. You. We have to decide what the... You know, Tri-Town Beach, the staffing is hourly salaries. I don't believe there's any other salary than the hourly salaries of the lifeguards.
There's some stipend for the commissioner.
Lifeguards, senior lifeguards, gatekeepers.
Sure.
Okay. Three positions.
Gatekeepers?
That's a position. Gatekeeper.
Make sure you have a
I've been going to Tri-Town Beach for I don't know how many years. I've never seen a gatekeeper.
Well, they don't get paid.
What?
Same one.
Oh, I see. The person one locks in line. The lifeguard can do it. It's the lifeguard.
Same one who does Whately Park.
I guess
that's how it's split. That's how it's split up.
I guess that's sort of my point. I mean, oh my gosh.
All right. We're not going to dock a gatekeeper.
So are we going to do capital now?
Yeah.
Capital, so you have a sheet here. FY 2018 capital project recommendations.
Yep.
Because so this is what the finance committee reviewed. So the first one, they recommended splitting the proposed purchase of turnout gear for the fire department over a two-year period. I'll tell you what the changes are. If we don't...
We're only going to put half the fire out. I'm not sure whether this is where I speak or not.
Sure.
Are you... What are we doing, Brian?
So it's one, this is the finance committee change, proposed
right.
changes.
Right.
One, two, three, the fourth one down.
Is fire department.
Is fire department.
Protective
yeah.
equipment.
And 61 is the new number or the old number?
61 is the old number. So they're recommending funding it over two-year
two
period.
So we're getting half suit so everybody can wear a frontal piece.
Well,
go into the fire
half,
front.
We can put half the fire out, they have options. Right. We can put half the fire out. We can just shoot it through a deck gun from the street because nobody's gonna be totally protected. Or you just buy new coats this year and buy the rest of the gear. I'm so confused. And I think it's like ludicrous that they think that they can only protect half the people that are gonna go fight a fire or
okay.
enter a building.
All right, so.
So, John, let me ask you a question. The fire protection,
for the Fire Protective Association code recommends that after 10 years, the stuff gets
Yes.
turned around.
Because what has happened, John, is they've had gear fail. It's, you know, and they've determined that it's like over 10 years old, so that they set a new standard.
On average, yeah.
Right.
I mean, sometimes the gear fails within 5 years because
oh.
it's defective or But sometimes it could last 15 years because it was just spot on.
Yeah, somebody goes on a job, they wash it 100 times, you know, whatever the case may be. I don't know the results of the test, okay?
Yeah.
But that's what has happened. So they changed the recommendation. They figured that gear that comes out of the factory is good for 10 years. And ours has been out for 2 years now. We're at 12 years now.
So we have 26.
No, that changed. I've had three people leave. So we're down to 23. That's where your numbers are. That's why the numbers went down from the original request of 70.
So 23 volunteers.
Mm-hmm.
And do they volunteer for other towns' fire service?
One does.
Oh, just one. And they don't split the cost with that other town?
No.
Beer.
In fact, he doesn't have... He's still in training, and we haven't determined anything about that. And I told him I wasn't going to split. I didn't want to split it with him.
All right. But, you know, as a rule, we have people that are working for Conway, say, as well as us. We should share the costs, right?
Right.
In principle.
Okay.
And if we buy 23 suits versus half of that, which is
12.
So we get a discount on, is it cheaper to buy them all at once?
No. But the salesman that I've been working with, I've worked with for years, did tell me that January 1st it'll go up 5%.
So we got to buy December 31st.
Yep.
It's going to go up 5% why?
Comes from the factory.
Why aren't
That's the way the factory says
it. Why aren't we just financing this over 2 years?
Because the finance committee said they want to do it for 2 years. Wait a minute, what was your question, John?
Why don't we buy them now and finance it over 2 years?
Oh, I don't know.
They were looking at free cash. They weren't looking at financing. It was mad interest.
But we can borrow against the free cash, is I guess my point.
But it kind of comes.
Yeah, yeah.
Comes down to what's the priority is to buy all the equipment there or delay the replacing the phones for the school department for a year. And who makes that decision?
We do.
Right, so if we decide we should do the fire equipment this year and forget school phones for a year, we can do that, is what you're saying. What's the higher priority, fire equipment or school phones?
And then we have to take the paddle to the town meeting and let people use it on us.
Will they see all this, or are they just going to see the items that we're funding?
Right, they're not going to see what we said
turned
no
down,
to.
Yeah, we said no to.
We should bring that as backup.
Well,
as
you,
a point
you,
of information.
You had other items on here. Library was on here, and I don't know what else was on here.
Did the finance committee, and I'm not picking on them, I'm just, did they give any rationale for why they accepted the phone system replacement?
It was a recommendation of the CPIC.
So was the protective equipment.
Capital planning. Yeah. Oh,
okay. But so was the protective equipment.
Yep.
So why did they pick? I mean,
why did they choose to cut it in half? Is that the question?
Well, I guess why did they choose to not fully fund that and fully fund the phone, the intercom system? Was there a conversation?
I mean, it's a question that we'll have to ask them when we meet with them.
Yeah.
But I think part of it was they questioned whether the National Fire Protection Association was a mandate or a recommendation.
My guess is it's guidelines, but...
So that's the conversation that happened.
There was also a conversation to fund half and try for a grant for the other half.
Of the equipment.
That was the conversation.
Yeah, what's the likelihood of that at this point? You know, zero.
Yep.
What was the priority? What's the priority rating of all of these? Ranking? Is this the order?
I believe that's the order. Yeah. Except for the bottom three numbers.
Yeah, right.
Those weren't touched by the CPIC.
I've talked to some people who don't think the intercom system is all that critical.
Yeah, so that's my question. What's with the phone clocks and intercom? They say it's a potentially unsafe situation, so...
In case of...
Apparently they can't communicate to the classrooms.
In case of hostage, yeah.
Active shooters. But don't we have door locks and all that other stuff as well?
They do, but you gotta get the message out to them.
And the intercom doesn't work, so...
Yeah, if the intercom doesn't work and you can't hear them, then you don't get locked in.
So the intercom doesn't work?
I think it's the phone.
Yeah, it's the phone that...
But the intercom does work?
Kinda, I think.
It's an old, it's the original system.
So it's 1990.
I'm not sure what they're, I'm not sure, are they posing the intercom system or the phone?
The whole shooting mark, shooting match.
Phone clock and intercom, it says.
I think it's, because I think you replace all of the separate pieces and you get, because of technology, a package. And I get that.
I know the phones have been done since the building's been updated, but the intercoms have not.
Right.
I don't know, that would simplify matters if we put them off for a year and then got the equipment this year and then...
And I get the risk.
They have walkie-talkies, there's...
Yeah, they do have walkie-talkies.
You know, without getting too much in detail about the school safety plans, I mean, there are redundancy systems in place.
Not to mention, I'm there, I'm screaming at the top of my lungs.
Yeah.
So you wouldn't feel like we're jeopardizing public safety by not replacing the system that this coming year?
Personally, no.
What's not shown on here is, there was also a request this year to replace the carpets in the schools, which the CPIC deferred and suggested that it be done over a four-year period. So there's another item on here.
Well, how much of carpets, I mean, how much carpets are, is every classroom carpeted?
60,000.
Except the art room, I don't think is carpeted.
60,000?
I mean, that's not on the request this year, but it is on the five-year plan.
Maybe we ought to delay the phone, the communication system.
That would be my vote, but again, you'll hear that counter argument.
Buy the fire equipment in one fell swoop this year and then pay for it.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know why we don't find, you know, I don't know what financing $61,000 would be, but it wouldn't be a lot of money.
Maybe it's also probably not necessary.
Yeah, well, if we find a replacement part, I agree, but if we wanted to say yes to everybody, which we're very good at doing.
If you're not funding the school.
Then you don't need to, right, that's sort of my point.
You're still quite a bit of free cash.
Yeah. I mean, that free cash is going to come in handy at some point because it's not like our budget is going to get better over the next few years.
But does the school have, can the school fund this in out of their budget though? Do they have money in their budget? I mean, they're the biggest expense.
No, they don't. It's not like they have some slush funds hidden away.
That's why it came to the...
Yeah, they don't.
They don't have that kind of... Several years.
Well, we can talk about it with the finance committee, but we should have that conversation as... My suggestion would be to put the phone system up one more year, but...
Yeah. Sounds reasonable.
Yeah, I agree with that too, yeah. Unless they can, the school can justify or describe more of what's unsafe and why it's needed. I mean, if there's nothing here today, it's not working at all, well, then that's a different story. Then the technology is not current, so it takes a minute to lock on or whatever.
Well, you'll appreciate the clock story. They don't want to manually adjust them twice a year.
Oh, that's big.
Yeah.
I'll tell you where I teach.
I manually adjust my clocks and my numbers.
I'm just saying.
Where I teach, clocks and every clock in the place says 1 o'clock all the time. So they're right twice a day.
We can have this conversation. And then, you know, on town meeting floor, people can argue one way or the other and see which way the wind's blowing.
Yeah. Well, if we buy the suits before December 31st, we save $3,000.
Which is one-tenth of, we'll be able to earmark for...
Well, we could buy more tasers.
Yeah. All right.
Okay.
Just for reference, what is, because I don't want to
what else, please remind me, what else was on the capital, what other capital requests did we get that the Finance Committee wants to say no to? Because we should be discussing all of this, again, if we're going to have a comprehensive
conversation. That they said no to?
Yes. That was, because I'm looking at four items not including.
They didn't say, they just pushed them out.
Right.
Okay, but what did they push out?
They were from the CPC. Well, there was the library improvements here they took that off. The trustees took that off.
Okay, that's their prerogative.
Command vehicle was deferred to next year.
That was my request.
Police cruiser was deferred to next year.
Carpeting
was deferred to next year.
Yeah. All right, I'm going to request that we don't have any new ones for next year so we can actually address the deferments, but that's just me.
New what?
Capital request.
Anything that's not at all. I mean, one of the things, I've had conversations with Fred about this before, about increasing our capital planning efforts and trying to beef up our capital plan.
Yes.
Trying to beef it up or not beef it up?
Beef it up.
Beef it up.
In terms of let's have some forethought and figure out what we're going to need over the next 5 years.
Right. I would agree with that. When are the roofs going to have to be replaced in all town-owned buildings? If you talked with the plumber that put in the boilers in all these rooms, they can tell you within the month when that boiler is going to go. When's it going to go?
All right, let's move on.
Other Finance Committee recommendations? So other than that, all these things on the chart, they were okay with. All these things on the table, they were okay with.
Okay.
There were some additions that they suggested. One was to create a police vehicle replacement account.
Yep.
And appropriate $10,000 from FY16 free cash with the intent of adding $10,000 each fiscal year to the account so that every 5 years the money is there to replace the cruiser. Because it's replaced on a three to five years.
It's been 5 years.
Do we do that with dump trucks? You got to account for, what, $30,000 for
fire trucks?
Fire trucks?
Ambulance.
Fire trucks. But we're going to propose.
The question is, should we, I guess?
$10,000 a year.
Well, but again, those are the easy things. People say, we don't have any money this year. We're just going to not forward fund the reserve account.
Could happen.
Right.
Yes, it could.
Well, it gets to another point of the lack of financial policies.
I agree. I mean, we just have to.
But rather than fund each type of vehicle, I mean, the other one we see, I think, is the water department's got in $5,000 a year. Why don't we look at a fund for a vehicle replacement and put so much money in, and everybody's on a schedule. If you're a certain age or certain mileage, well, then we fund that vehicle out of that account.
I think that's a great idea. There's only one problem.
It's to put money into that account.
It's to have enough money to put it into the account.
And?
Or we limit it to, I don't know, passenger or vehicles under a certain dollar limit, which would exclude a dump truck and a fire truck, I guess, would be different. But you guys still need the lesser expensive vehicles. You need a personal vehicle or trucks or whatever. So that would be in that same account as the police vehicle, as the water department vehicle.
So it's the same thing, but you just have to put more into one account.
You're right. Planning, right. But we don't have, it doesn't seem like we have the capacity to say no to anything.
Well, you can't say, we know at some point we're going to replace the cruiser.
I get it.
So there's nothing saying that when it reaches that amount, you have to buy the cruiser.
Oh, you know very well that we're going to say, the money's there.
In either case, you're going to buy the cruiser. So, but then you have to go out and finance it, as opposed to a little bit of forethought, and we start saying with the dump truck, the dump truck, $160,000. You got 10 years to at least get maybe $100,000 into an account.
Honestly, I think I like Fred's idea about just making a vehicle account, because then you don't have, in 50 years, when none of us are here and Jim's not the chief, the next chief isn't saying, the money's in my account. It's not in Hannum's account. It's not in Bardwell's account. It's in my account. Then that takes the prioritization and the policy-making discretion from this group away from us and puts it
I don't know if you can make a joint account like that. We'd have to check with the accountant.
Why can't you just have the capital stabilization?
We have one.
We have one.
And on town meeting floor 5, 6, 7 years ago, we were told that the select board should not have control over that because they can't be trusted and it would just be the select board slush fund.
Plus it's a two-thirds
which I took personally.
The capital stabilization is a two-thirds vote to take it out.
Right.
So.
But that's also roofs. I mean, there's more to that. Yeah.
The vehicles, it becomes...
Yeah. Let's create a vehicle, if we're allowed to, create a vehicle stabilization account. And if we're allowed to just put it into one pot...
I think we can create any kind of account we want, can't we? What's the stop us? If we have money to put into it, that's what I wonder about.
Right. And we can save it in different ways.
Yeah. Right.
But
stabilization
account, two-thirds in, two-thirds out. Town meeting.
Well, you got 10,000 a year. You got, well, water is 5,000 a year, and I don't know if anything else
that's
is.
That's out of their enterprise.
That comes out of their enterprise. That's different. Yeah, that's not.
It's all on their own.
Well, so let's say we started a fund for cars, and we started a fund for, I don't know, what else?
Just dump trucks.
Dump truck.
That's it.
But then we decided, oh, we want to move the money from one account to another. Do we need a two-thirds town vote to move that?
Yeah, that's why I don't understand why we don't just have one big account.
Well, because one big account is like a general fund where you turn around and all of a sudden, every year you say, oh, we got some money in the general fund, let's use that for this.
We can put money into capital stabilization.
Right.
It needs to be, we can put money in, it takes town meeting appropriation to take it out. So the concern about anybody can just, the select board can just spend it on whatever they want is not true.
For
money needs to be appropriated by town meeting out of capital stabilization.
I understand that.
So if we wanted one big account, that's the account we would put this in.
I understand that. You understand that, but convince town meeting that.
But I think the feeling is that from town meeting is that you guys are deciding what they get to vote on. But you're going to decide if John gets his truck or if I get my cruiser, you're going to decide what goes on there. And then the town can vote yes or no for that. They're not going to have the decision to say, well, do we want the truck, or do we want the car, do we want the pickup truck, or do we want...
That should stem from the Capital Improvement Committee.
It should.
It should start there.
Right. To give the town the option of what they want.
Well, and the town, on town meeting floor, someone could ask, what didn't get recommended? But that's the pros and cons of the archaic form of government we have. Not that I'm forming an opinion on town meeting.
Okay,
so
we're gonna kick the can.
Look at that.
But okay. Come up with an amount you want to put in yearly. And if we were going to do 10 for a cruiser and 10 for a dump truck, you gonna propose 20 for the new push? No. 10's not gonna get you anywhere. If you're gonna pull it all out of one.
But do we want to put the dump truck in there though?
We just got done saying that.
Well, no, we didn't. No. We didn't say that. I don't think anyone said yes up here. We want the dump truck.
You said vehicles.
I said vehicles. I didn't.
Well,
not truck. Not dump truck. Vehicles except dump truck and except fire truck. I guess
vehicles are fire trucks, police cruisers,
bucket loaders,
any number of things.
Well, no, I get all that. But then you've got to put in a lot more money.
I get that, but again, we're all of a sudden prioritizing that a dump truck's more important than it. Just there's no rhyme or reason.
That's the process that Fred and I have been discussing for a while, is to try to get our hands around, heads wrapped around everything. So we'll know amounts, we'll know, we'll be able to prioritize a little bit better. We can plan better and we can save better.
Capital planning is supposed to do this.
It is.
Yeah, so.
It's supposed to, yeah. But.
Right now, I don't feel like I have a complete picture of what the capital needs are.
Yeah. Well, you know, I think we should maybe look into some software that would help us do capital planning. And make it more data-driven as opposed to the whims of individuals, because it should be data-driven.
Well, that's part of it, but I think all the players need to come together that have capital needs and talk about
it.
It's
not like we don't do this. It's just...
Well.
What else?
Just in reference to the cruiser, if you're talking about putting $10,000 away to replace a cruiser into that account, you already have a cruiser that's up for replacement now. That's 5 years. It's going to take you 4 or 5 years to get the money to buy a cruiser. Now the cruiser is going to be 10 years old. if you don't do something.
How many miles run that cruiser?
What's that?
How many miles run that cruiser?
Almost 110 right now.
The proposal was to perhaps only put 10,000 and use it next year, but a continuous 10 for your next cruiser.
Yeah, that's what my proposal was.
I talked to the finance committee about we're not starting year one on the on the first cruiser. If we were starting at 10, it's
okay. You can start that now.
And for the next one,
the cruiser we just got.
In order to add up.
But where are we going with this?
One of the four. I don't know.
Well, let's
go think about it.
Yeah.
Talk to the finance committee about it.
Yes, that's what I want to do.
Yeah. Okay. Recommendation: appropriate $5,000 for repair to the highway garage.
For what?
This was instigated by me.
That was instigated by Dan.
To just start on the walls, to start patching some of the walls. To start it, well, you can't call it, we wanted to call it a stabilization fund, but you can't. So it was mainly a maintenance fund.
Keith, will you give a summary of what Thayer Street Associates told us in our meeting?
Sure. Basically, Thayer Street Associates came, met with myself, Brian, and two of the selectmen. And in a nutshell, the main focus was, that I requested them was to say, to find out, are we foolish for putting any capital money into this building, or is it beyond repair? They looked at it and said that while there's some certainly structural issues, that they didn't feel that it was in any imminent danger of falling down within her in a few years. However, they did say that we need to begin to make some serious thoughts on doing something for the future. So after we looked at it, we felt that certainly it would be worth putting the money, putting a roof into it, but in the meantime, we need to begin to focus on making more permanent repairs, because the building, the cinder block that are there have outlived their basic life expectancy. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, essentially, we all agree that the building won't be there in 10 years.
It would still probably be there about, you know, but you're not going to get 30 years out.
No, I mean, I think the guy said 10 years was...
That was our estimate, what did you do for 10 years?
And then after that, it's... You know,
and so at this point in time, since that meeting just happened, I haven't gone back to do anything other than I did talk to the contractor who did the roof proposal and asked him to update me on the fascia and the trim board, which are rotted out, and he told me to figure adding $1,000 into that would take care of all that. As far as the proposal that Dan's talking about, going through and doing some cinder block repair.
Not foundation, just walls.
He was talking just the walls. It's something that could be done. Another thing that I still, in my own mind, wonder is if we could core into the cinder blocks at near ground level and pour some type of a concrete in there to solidify the area that's but I don't know. I don't even have an estimate for how much it's going to cost to do any of this stuff, because it's just come about in the last. And so does $5,000 cover it? Maybe not. I don't know. I don't know how anybody's going to defend that on town meeting if we don't have, if we have a question of what we're going to do with it and we don't have an answer, it's not going to look good.
Right. And I'm not sure there's an answer.
I think it's too early to figure out money to put into the account without
you. I mean, at the moment, you know, I know what Jonathan just said, don't look at any new capital items for next year, but the highway department, the request for the roof for 25 that sits right now for 25,000 was put on 2-3 years ago, somewhere in that range, in that slot, basing on where I felt it needed to be done. That's one of the things I try to do is I put projects on there that are 5 years out. So that when the time gets there, you can't say, well, geez, nobody told me. So when I put a project on there, you know about it well in advance. Anyways, that $25,000 will be up for the next fiscal year, which means if it gets funded, that roof work could start July of 2018.
The roof work being the shingles.
So what I'm getting at is if we want to expand it a little bit more, if we feel we don't have the time frame right now to get a grip on how much it's going to cost to shore up the building a little bit, for instance, what I'm saying is we could wait and then increase, say, that, get some more estimates and come back to town meeting for the roof and the shoring up all at once. And maybe instead of the 25 or 26,000, it'll be in the low 30s. I certainly see where Dan is. After I talked to him today, I can certainly see where he's coming from. I don't have a problem with that. But at the moment, I just don't know if that's enough or not enough. Because I haven't asked anybody to come. It's a starting point.
There's more of that west wall that's where the windows get crushed.
Right, there's something going on in that part of the building, which is, there's a lot of...
What did Thayer say about that, anything?
That the cinder blocks have outlasted their
life expectancy. Right, so it's not going to fall down anytime soon. They recommended injecting some concrete.
They've definitely suggested that the building get, that we do something to keep the water out.
And
basically, the biggest issue was getting it pressure washed and painted. However, a lot of that, when you get up towards the trim part of it, that's where the roof comes into play, and you can't paint all your trim board until the roof is taken off and you put new drip edge on. And so when the gutters are removed and you put new roof on, you put new drip edge on, that's when you replace the fascia boards.
Sure.
But they're saying, like you said, Keith, that it's not in imminent danger of collapsing. And I guess until we decide what's an appropriate fix, whether it's short-term or long-term, I think we need to, or maybe you need to get more information on the cost to do some of these fixes.
And I don't have a problem with doing that. It's just that the timing of this.
Right.
For this.
Just
budget season is
Another thing, I don't know if it's a possibility if I can push forward and get some good estimates and some good ideas on what could be done. What's the possibility of addressing something like this at a special town meeting?
Well, what about if we took the $5,000 and just added it to? Do we have an appropriation for capital stabilization this time around or no?
Not yet.
So, but let's say we don't. Let's put it into capital stabilization with the notation that this was for easily foreseeable shoring up of the highway garage with the thought that it be added to whatever requests may come from the highway garage in next fiscal year.
I mean, we could put money into stabilization for that, or if it remains in free cash, it's going to flip. It's just going to flip to next year's free cash amount. So as long as we don't appropriate that money out, it's not going to go anywhere.
Right, I get that, but you know what? Why not just put it in? Because that'll give the townspeople comfort that it's a 2/3 vote, and we're going to have a plan.
I think we're jumping ahead by putting money into an account for a highway garage without knowing what else we need out there. John brought up an item that he needs to repair his building. That may be more important than a new roof right now on the highway garage. And we don't know that. And to put a earmarked money for highway garage improvements is premature without knowing what these other buildings need. And that's one of the things that I'll get on my soapbox with Brian, talking about a capital improvement plan that has
input from all the people that have buildings in town, that have to maintain the buildings, the structure itself. What do you need to maintain it? You need to get an inventory first of what you have, see what you have, and figure out how long it's going to last. And have a committee that's representative of all these people in town that are responsible for that building. And they decide what's priority among them. Does John decide whether it's more important for him to fix his building than Keith? And if you have five or six people, them are the people, I think, that have ownership to the building, and they should have some input in what gets fixed and establishing a priority, because they know the buildings. They know the condition. We don't know the condition of that. Finance Committee doesn't know the condition of any of the buildings in town. And yet they're setting money aside for improvements. They don't know what's more important for an improvement. And we need to identify that, put it on a plan. John wants improvements in 5 years. That's what our goal is, to look at that in 5 years. And maybe Keith's roof comes in before that or after that. But it's that committee that has knowledge of the buildings. They make an inspection. They do a review. They see the condition. We don't know the condition. All of that is to have that committee get together, and they make a recommendation. If you want to do it, the Capital Improvement Committee or Finance Board, as to what our capital project should be for maintaining our buildings. We're not doing that now.
Can the Capital Improvement Committee get more involved in? It seems like they probably only, how many times a year do they meet?
Once, that's it.
All right, so I think that there's some of the answer, that they need to be more involved.
Right, but I'm saying,
but there are no experts on the capital.
There are no experts. Yeah. You need people that are responsible for maintaining that building. Right. To identify what needs to be done and set up a schedule for what you think is important and when it needs to be done.
Well, I think, Fred, we need to actually, instead of relying on these guys who may be experts about building construction technology, or not,
that's where you then need to have someone that the town, so to speak, hires to be a facilities manager.
To look at all the facilities.
That knows these things.
All that stuff.
And, you know, well, you talk to these department heads like Jim and myself. That's not our forte.
Or have them on retainer so that when, you know, it's not a full-time gig, but.
To have them on retainer to help if you identify something but don't know how to fix it or what the cost is.
That's what I'm.
Yeah, you could do that.
No, I think we should. I think we should have the Capital Improvement Committee should have a consultant come in and do an appraisal of all our buildings, or, you know,
do it over a period of time.
What?
I got to believe somebody in town has that skill.
I've seen that done in other towns.
There are different types of buildings.
You know, I get it, but structural engineers are structural. I mean,
well, we're not just talking structural engineering either. Structural engineers are good at designing structures, but there's more to a building than the structure, so maybe you need an architect as well.
But that's only going to give you part of the story. You still need somebody to prioritize what's most important.
Well, that should be the capital improvement. Well, we're talking to these guys about, you know, what they need, and talking to the facilities person about what's going to come crashing down when, so we can avoid that.
Okay.
Yeah, we don't want
to
go.
I think that the start is to get a committee together to see if these departments are interested in that, and see what their focus is, what their interest is, and whether they want outside help, whether now or later, and go from there. But to hire somebody now and go to talk to each one of them and write down everything that they say is wrong, we're not gaining anything. It's just another report.
Well,
they can do that themselves.
I think it's a great idea, and something that we should do.
Yeah.
But right now, we should finish going over the budget.
Right, okay. So,
anything else on the budget?
What did we decide on this item for the $5,000 for the highway garage?
I think we wait on that.
Delay that?
I agree.
Yeah.
Okay.
If you look at a sheet called Statement of Account Balances.
Yeah, is this enterprise capital? Statement of account balance.
So what this shows, and these figures are based on a couple things. This is our free cash balance. The FY18 capital expenditures, as listed in the sheet, we just discussed, which is getting tweaked, obviously. We could pay for it out of free cash. $200,000 is a proposed tax levy reduction. And then this is the other item we have to talk about. Retirement benefits payout. And this is worst case scenario. This number is worst case scenario. We don't think it's going to be that much. I was talking with Keith this morning, but one of our employees is going to be retiring after 31 years. 31 years of service. So there is some benefits payout that we need to cover.
That's an annual thing, right? That's not just a one-time payout.
No, this would be the one-time.
Oh, it would be?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. For unused leave time.
Oh, okay. Wow, that's...
Half of that would be... So for sick time, we pay out 8 hours per year of service. So we've been here 30.
But that's 30, capped,
31
isn't it?
Years. The payout's not capped.
It's 240 hours.
For sick time. You get 8 hours for every year of service if you retire from the town.
And you don't take?
No.
Well, you have regardless to have the sick time in the bank. You mean,
right, you have to have sick time.
Right. You have to have sick time left. If you have no sick time,
right,
you don't get a pay.
I get that. Okay. So, and it's not capped.
No cap on sick time.
Well, sick time's capped.
Yeah, what you can carry over.
And it's not capped.
It is.
Yes.
Well,
the buyout is based on the years of service.
Based on years of service.
I mean, that's
when
not
you
capped.
Have to retire, that's a requirement. You can't work 20 years and say, okay, I'm going to take another job in another town. It was a requirement that you had to stay, you have to retire. So it's not, it won't always affect everybody, but it's one day, you get paid one day for every year of service, provided you have that sick time in your...
But that you haven't taken.
You haven't taken, correct.
And there's no cap on how many days you haven't taken. I guess
there's cap on that.
How many years you've worked.
No, if I haven't taken a sick day in my life, and I work for 30 years.
You would have 720 hours in the bank of sick time. Sense.
But it's just one day per year out of that. It's not,
right.
You're not
but
getting
your sick
hours.
Time would be at the maximum at that point. If you don't take any sick time, you work that many years. You'd have 720 hours in the bank.
For full-time.
For full-time, somebody working 40 hours.
So, and this employee has, so it's got a lot in the bank.
30, well, enough so you've got to have more than 30 days is what it comes
he's
out.
He's covered his hours.
Yes.
He's used some sick time, but he still has a lot left.
Yeah, okay.
This is, you know, something like this that goes on with the school, their policy pays them a heck of a lot more.
A lot.
Almost. I mean, when their payout of a retiree, that's probably close to double.
Okay. I'm not going to win this argument. So,
so that's that's projected what would be remaining, 217.
Where were we last year after the projected free cash usage?
After last year? I'd have to check.
Do you remember ballpark, Marianne?
No.
I mean, before the 545 came out?
What did, yeah. So when, you know, whatever our free cash balance was on March, what's today's date? The 26th, 7th, whatever it is.
Yeah. I don't think I have last year's.
2016.
And what was that? And then we took out, we had X, we took out Y, and that left us with Z. And I want to know how the Z compares to this year.
I'll have to get back to you. I don't think I didn't take a...
We took out 200 last year again, didn't we?
Yeah. Well, we're taking out 327 this time.
No, but I mean, but at least for the tax levy, we took out...
Yeah, no, I'm talking the whole shooting match.
Yeah.
Again, it's all $327,750 is what we're taking out. It that's the nut. And you don't remember you? Okay.
I'd have to go look. I can get it for the April 5th meeting.
So, in terms of reducing the tax levy, which... So that's a good idea. If we're not just going to have to turn around and then spend that money next year and raise the tax levy again. I'm not sure. I mean, I get the desire to reduce the tax levy. Is it the most prudent thing to do? Or does it put us in jeopardy for the next year in terms of not having enough money and then having to raise the levy?
So what it's doing now is, I know I've used this term before, and I don't think it's the best term to use, but it's keeping it artificially lower with one-time revenue.
Right.
If we didn't have, so let's say for FY17, there was a $200,000.
So our tax rate is going to be lower by $200,000.
So our tax rate, well, our tax receipts would likely stay the same, okay, but our tax rate would have gone up more.
Sure.
Probably significantly more. So right now it's at a level where we're kind of keeping it low with one-time infusions of essentially cash. I mean, we're keeping it lower with the one-time infusions of free cash.
Yeah.
I don't think that is sustainable long-term.
Right.
We do have there is a $200,000 that we know for sure is coming into next year's free cash. That was the $200,000 that was put aside from Covestro's first tax payment.
Yes. Which we didn't use this year for whatever reason.
Which we did not use this year.
Transfer too late.
I knew the reason. I was just not.
That's it for them, right?
So. Yes.
And let's avoid a feeding frenzy, by the way, on that money.
So.
But we have a big net loss because of that.
Yeah. Well, we have that this year,
it's
too.
It's about... Right, part of the increase this year was the shifting of the tax burden from a single large taxpayer to everybody else.
Well, right, but
so that money is going to show up in free cash.
I'm sorry.
That money is going to show up in free cash this fall, in FY17 free cash, on top of whatever we have in excess revenue or unspent budget. So.
All right.
And then, so there's no proposals to touch capital stabilization or stabilization or to add to it. That's one way that we can pay for these items.
That we've been talking about, or Rich, these items.
Right. I mean, we could, right now they're presented separate because it would be a separate source of funding other than the tax levy. We could shift them into the tax levy, but I don't think we really necessarily need to do that with the existing funds we have.
So Brian, these numbers here on the first table, if we accepted these numbers, would we be balanced?
Balanced in what sense?
Does this pay for what we're spending?
Will our budget be balanced?
Yeah.
Well, it will be. We're required to balance.
I understand that, but does the if we take $200,000 out for the levy reduction, and then, I mean, if we spend this $327,000 out of free cash.
Yep.
In addition to all the other revenue that we have,
yep,
will we be balanced? Or do we need to find extra money somewhere to be balanced?
Balanced meaning the same tax rate as last year?
We pay all the debt at a higher tax rate.
Everything will be paid for, but there will be an increase
in the tax rate. By how much?
Depends how we want to project.
Ballpark it.
Let's say 14 cents based on FY17 values. That's one of the big catches here. If we see an increase in assessed values, let's say we see an increase in assessed values of $1 million in assessed value, well, that's going to drop that number. That might drop that number by half.
Right, it's an unknown.
Or in the opposite direction, the state cuts our unrestricted general aid, or that would take away other non-property tax revenue, which we need to make up.
I want to avoid lowering something when we are just going to simply have to ask for an increase
next year that allows
some people to say, look at how much you guys are raising on my taxes. Well, if we hadn't buckled under the pressure to lowering the tax rate, and it's sort of like when Washington cuts taxes, and it's guaranteed to, the tax cut is guaranteed to sunset in 10 years, and all of a sudden the next administration is saying, yeah, look at those people raising the taxes. I worry that when we are looking to lower the tax rate, it is so that it makes it harder to increase taxes down the road.
But that doesn't seem to be a problem so far. Because look at what we do here. Look at, we went down 16 down to 14, nearly jumping up every year after that, and it keeps getting approved.
I'd like us to keep in mind
what I said to begin with,
and that is we need to talk about this in the context of education financing in the coming years. Because I suspect we are going to, if we keep having increases of that magnitude, if we get $100,000 each year,
right? Well,
I don't know where the money's going to come from.
It's conversation.
It's either going to be cuts or it's going to be increases in the tax rate. So I could see. We need to get a hold of that.
And the school's already forewarned us it's going to be detrimental next year.
Yeah,
they can't figure it out themselves.
It did happen in our budget meeting with the school. School choice receiving tuition can't cover what it used to.
Well, it never goes up. The fee is still at $5,000.
Yeah, but the number of students we have coming in is dropping.
Yes, right.
Exactly. And no one's asking why.
And we're still, you know.
But I think the finance committee's kind of been asking what needs to be done to the school budget? Well, if you keep the school budget uniform or very minor increase, what needs to be done? What needs to be sacrificed? What do you need to cut? And they're not looking at that. It's like, well, our teachers and our union told us we committed to this stuff and we need increase by this amount. And finance is saying, well, if you don't increase by that amount, what are you sacrificing? They don't know. They don't look at it that
there's
way.
There's one teacher per classroom, there's one aide per classroom. There aren't a lot of places to cut. And we don't get anything, and they never ask for anything new. I mean, I wish they'd ask for something new.
Cut teachers.
I would be hard pressed to say no to Chromebooks for every student. That's a hard thing to say no to. But I don't ever see that request.
Well, isn't that coming along though? Isn't somebody saying they should have that?
I think they should.
Some schools are doing that. I don't know how they're funding it or whether there's state money for it or what, but
they should. I mean, it's modern. It's 21st century education. But we're not getting anything new for the budget increase. We're just getting status quo for the budget increases.
But it's a conversation we can't start January 1st.
Right.
Because it's just too.
All right.
We're too compressed, and budgets are set, and teacher contracts are set for 3 years, and everybody says we can't do anything about it. Well, we could have, and we can in the future.
Well, that's what a lot of this is getting down to, is more foresight and planning.
Yes.
And, we don't have fat budgets.
No, we don't. We need economic development.
We do need economic development. We need somebody in this building paying rent, for starters. And we have some space for commercial development.
We've got almost no land for commercial or industrial.
What happened?
Our zoning boards ruled out any of the marijuana. They put it all into industrial, which we don't have any. So it's like catch 22. Deerfield's marching away. They're laughing at us.
Right.
Got a room right back there.
You do? Mm.
All right. Well, we're not going to solve that problem here. What else do we have? Anything on the agenda?
Bridges.
In terms of wrapping up the budget, are we good to go to April 5th meeting?
I think so.
It's going to be a conversation.
Yeah.
Right.
And then we'll individually vote on what we recommend and what we don't recommend.
Right. I don't think we're that far off.
No. A few things, but.
So that's what will happen.
Okay.
On Wednesday, April 5th.
Okay.
And they'll vote on it. You guys can vote on it. And the intent being that you would sign the warrant on April 10th.
So are you going to give us budget numbers based on, you know, what you heard today? We're concerned with some of these items. If these don't get approved by us, are you going to have another budget number? I assume these are in there, right? The vehicle account, the highway garage repairs, and what the other item was doing, the full fire department and reducing the school time clocks or whatever. You will give us a budget number?
Well, I'll have to give you a budget number depending on the outcome of your conversation.
Okay, so
with
we
the
won't
finance
know that
committee.
Until after, okay.
Right. Well, no, I'm going to have to do some calculations during the meeting so that the finance committee can vote.
Oh, okay.
All right, so Williamsburg Road Bridge update, if anything.
All right. So this is when we can announce publicly that we have received an award from MassDOT to reopen the Williamsburg Road Bridge, to replace the Williamsburg Road Bridge that's been closed for 6 years? Four years?
Yeah. At least six.
Yeah. So we're getting about just under $500,000 to replace that closed bridge and to do the abutment work for another bridge on that road in anticipation of getting a temporary deck installed on it.
So that's for two bridges?
Yeah, well.
It's for to completely replace the first, the closed one with a permanent bridge.
Yeah.
And then to do the design and abutment work for a second bridge. And to put a temporary deck on that.
Okay. And that money will be available this year? When's it?
Should be.
Okay.
Yeah. We'll ask that question on Wednesday.
We'll get specifics on Wednesday.
Sure.
Then we go out with an RFP type of thing?
Nope.
No. You can just, the state does it?
No, this, designers don't need to welcome it. So for vertical construction, for both projects.
So Keith would hire a...
So we just hire a bridge builder?
Consultant to design it?
We would hire an engineer to design it.
So we get to design the bridge? But it has to be according to state regs.
Right.
And then, so it's not going to be a four-lane highway bridge.
No.
Six.
But so the $500,000 pays for just the design or design
no,
and construction?
Everything.
Okay.
I like those ones.
What about local technical assistance?
DLTA, we have received an award from FERCOG to do whatever economic development study or activity we would like to do.
Oh, yeah. Good.
It's a grant. It's not a grant of money. It's a grant of their time to assist us.
Okay.
We
can noodle that.
So.
Okay.
If you want.
How much?
They don't tell us. They just tell us that we have.
How many hours? I mean, that hinges on what.
It fluctuates. It fluctuates.
Okay.
They don't commit. They don't commit to hours because they can shift things around.
Okay.
If they want it.
Well, of course.
New business. Keith left. Snow and emergency ice declaration. Did leave.
Yeah.
He projects that he is going to need to deficit spend the winter roads budget by approximately. His projection was around $3,500. Mm-hmm. In order to deficit spend winter roads, we needed an authorization from the chief administrative officer, which is you, folks.
Sure.
And what is the increase for?
They use more
labor, materials, salt. Or what? What is it?
It's a combination of salaries and materials. So he overspent his winter roads.
But
budget.
did we guess wrong on the budget? Because it hasn't been a brutal winter.
Yeah.
Oh, but there was more ice incidents than normal. Even though it wasn't a brutally cold winter, but there were.
All right. Well, I have no problem with it. I'm going to do it.
Right. But to pay for salary increases, I think I've asked Mary Ellen this before. If the guys are out there 20 hours plowing, they're entitled to overtime.
Time and a half.
on that, and is there an option to do comp time instead of that?
They can, but you still have to pay it at some point.
Right.
Whether it's comp time or they take it straight. For the most part, they take it at time and a half.
Right, but who? But it's up to them to decide mm-hmm. which way they want to go.
They decide which way they want to go.
Because I guess the other option is, you know, if they took comp time instead of the time and a half, you would save that some of that increase, I guess. But
I don't think you'd have any employees. They count on that.
Right.
That's okay. Part of their.
And I think Keith has to do comp.
Well, Keith does. He's the salary, but for the hourly right. employee,
but I think he's also doing comp time.
Yeah,
right.
There's no option for Keith.
Yeah.
Right.
So it's just the other three.
All right.
Are we good on the authorization?
Yeah.
Okay.
Three votes.
Three votes.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Julia and Nancy.
Cultural council appointments. We need to appoint folks to the cultural council. We had a communication a while ago from Larry Cutner about the need to appoint members because they are falling behind. They're falling below even
the quorum.
Yeah. I don't know if you remember that. And he's leaving. So he sent us a letter, email that said Nancy was willing to do it, and that Adelia Bardwell had also volunteered.
Wow.
Perfect.
To be on the cultural council.
Another motion. Committee. Second. Okay. In favor?
Yeah.
Aye.
Okay. Future meetings. Next Wednesday.
What?
Well, actually, this is your regular meetings. Traditionally, you have a board meeting before town meeting. But your regular board meeting night would be the day before the 24th. So I'm assuming you want to skip the 24th and go with meeting at 6 o'clock on the 25th.
Yes.
For town meeting, and then yes. Memorial Day is May 29th, which would be your last meeting in May. Do you want to do the 22nd instead? So May would be the 8th and the 22nd.
I'd rather do the 30th personally.
Oh, Paul, will you be out of school?
Oh, yeah, by then. Yeah.
I'd rather do the 30th. Mondays beginning on April 24 are going to be very difficult for me until June
11, 12. Okay, so May 30th at 6 still?
That's a Tuesday at 6.
Tuesday.
Yeah.
And I can't do it. Oh, yeah, I can do that.
May 30th at 6.
Will you be out of school by May
8th? Yeah, I'll be out of school by May 8th, yeah.
Well, will you all switch from the 8th to the 9th as well or no?
Which day of the week is the 9th or Wednesday?
Tuesday.
I'd rather not because I have other.
All right, I won't be here. Which
Tuesday meetings?
Okay.
So what are we saying? May
1? Wait. So you don't want to do the 30th either?
Yeah, 30th is fine. I can go with one, but not both.
All right.
Okay. So May 8th is going to be 6 o'clock.
But I won't be there.
Two of you here for that, and May 30th will be at 6 o'clock.
And okay. And April 24 will be 25.
Yes, April 24.
At 6. Okay.
Okay.
All right.
April 24.
Can we do the Conway request?
Yep. TA updates. Who wants to march in a parade?
When?
Oh, good question.
June 16th,
June.
17th.
It's June.
I'm going to say it's June 17th or 18th.
17th, 18th, yeah.
I wouldn't, but I don't have any.
I'm a maybe.
I can get you that.
We just need two people. The Historic Society has put in together a little presentation to be in the parade. They need two people to hold the banner.
Oh my goodness. Hold on.
That's not right.
Basically, we're going to do the milk bottle on a little tractor, and it's going to be pulled by the lawnmower and a lawnmower, and then to the.
In Conway,
and then to the two people then holding the banner in front of.
Well, I can't do it.
No, you won't be an official at that point.
You can drive still do it.
Maybe.
Our milk bottle goes to Conway.
Well, the 18th is Father's Day. They're going to have a parade on Father's Day?
Well, maybe it's the day before.
17th?
I mean, that's day three of the U.S. Open.
Okay.
It's Conway's 250th anniversary of U.S. Open.
I just don't know if I'm going to have a baseball tournament, but sure, I'll say yes.
Okay.
I don't think I'm going to be available.
No. I'll do it.
You said no.
I don't think so. No.
I'll do it.
Okay.
Send the date. We'll reaffirm the date.
Okay.
Yeah, find that end time.
Okay. All right.
Are we good?
Anything else? Move to adjourn.
Done.
Okay.